interested at all in quantum computing. So what is which could make quantum computers interesting? I think that there are two main reasons, one which is more fundamental and the other one which is actually practical. So the fundamental reason is that every time that we think about information, we cannot think about it just in an abstract sense, but information must be encoded in something physical. So we need our classical computer, my laptop here, and in general some physical system which will carry the information. And so even when we do some information processing, what we are actually doing is just making a system, a physical system, evolve in time. So this is what a computation really means. And up to now, what we have done is just to use the laws of classical physics in order to perform this kind of computations. So we know that the law of classical physics are not the fundamental truth, if you want. There is a theory which is underneath classical physics, which has more power, if you want, than classical physics. And so the question is, why not try to exploit these other set of laws, which we know are more fundamental, in order to perform computation on physical system? And the hope is that by exploiting these other laws, we will have something, a computer, so a quantum computer, which is more powerful than the classical one. There is also, if you want, another very practical reason, and the problem is that we have computers which are getting smaller and smaller. So if we look at the size of components in classical computers nowadays, they started from very large size, if you want, and I didn't plot what it was even before here when we had, for example, tubes, etc. But we started from something on the order of centimeters, and nowadays we are already on the range of nanometers size. And at this type of scales, we start seeing quantum effect in play. In some sense, classical computers are already quantum because semiconductor technology does use quantum effect, but we are not really using this fact. What we are trying to do is just to beat anything which could emerge as a quantum effect and trying to ignore it so that it doesn't come and perturb what is the normal operation of a classical computer. So with quantum computer, what we want to do is sort of take the different approach, not try to fight any quantum effect which arises because of this miniaturization of our component, but instead try to exploit the fact that we can really have fabrication at the nanoscale size. So this plot here is actually follow an empirical law that Gordon Moore had proposed in 65, and you can think of him as really sort of forward-thinking because he managed to sort of predict that the size of computers would just decrease by doubling the number of transistors in a chip every year. And it seems that this very empirical law, there is nothing which sort of predicts it, actually is quite well applied. So there are these two reasons, at least in my view, why we should try to build a quantum computer, but then the question is, what would be a quantum computer? So how would we implement a quantum computation? And the basic of it is very, very simple. So we know that information normally comes in bits. So a bit can be in a state of either 0 or 1. So this will be your classical bit. And what we want is to have the equivalent in quantum mechanics. So we want a quantum system which can be in either two states. And these are usually labeled with this notation here, which is just called Dirac notation, because we need some math to represent our basic units in quantum computing. Physically, for example, you could think of your 0 and 1 like being a spin, so for example, just a small magnetic dipole, which is either pointing parallel to an external magnetic field or in the opposite direction. So everything seems quite similar. Instead of having, for example, an open or closed circuit as in classical computer, you would have a different kind of system which can be in two possible states. So where is the power of quantum computer which could enter? The point is that in a quantum bits, which we usually call qubit, can be not only in either the 0 or 1 state. They can actually be in the 0 and 1 state at the same time. So this is a so-called superposition state, which is something which comes from quantum theory again. And the meaning of this is that we have that with alpha square probability, our system is in the 0 state. And of course, with beta's square probability, it is in the one state. But really, it's not just a matter of probability. We can really be at the, in these two different states at the same time. And that is where really the power of quantum computation, we will see, will come from. To make this a bit more clear, I just want to present a very simple example, a very simple experiment that we can actually do in the laboratory. But here I will just make it very cartoonish. So let's say that we have a very simple optic experiment. So I have a source of photons, and I'm able to produce single photons at demand. So every time that I look at this, I will adjust one photon inside my experiment. And then I just have a beam splitter. So a beam splitter is an object we can just redirect a photon into possible direction. And in this case, I'm assuming that the probability of going either up or horizontally is just 50-50. So if I send one photon, it will happen that it can go in either two direction, and I have a 50-50 probability of detecting the photon in either two of my detectors here. So this seems okay, it's just a game of probabilities. It doesn't look so much different than if I just take a classical point of view. So the analog of this, for example, is let's say we have a hiker which goes on a hike, and then it arrives at a fork in its path, and it doesn't know where to go. So what he does is just flip a coin. The coin gives him 50-50 probability of choosing one of the two paths. And well, with 50% probability, just get lost in the woods. And a 50% probability arrives to the cabin where he wanted to arrive, safe. So the two experiment, if you want, the quantum mechanical one and the classical one, seems up to now completely equivalent. So where does the power of quantum mechanics come in? So what we have to do is to just slightly modify this simple experiment. So now, instead of having the two detectors here, what I want to do is I take them out and I put two mirrors. And now the photons are redirected toward this path, and I add a second beam splitter, which again does this game of introducing a 50-50 probability of going in one direction or the other. So the question is, what will be the probability of arriving here and arriving at the second detector here? We don't know, and so we could think in terms of our classical intuition and see what is my analogy with the hiker, what he will tell us in terms of what is the probability of arriving here. So the classical counterpart of this is I have my hiker, he took his coin toss, he selected one of two possible paths, but now here it arrives again at another fork. And so what the hiker does is just toss his coin again. So toss his coin again, and then he has some 50% probability of being lost in the woods and 50% of arriving in the cabin. If in the first fork it had chosen the second path here, then again it would have arrived at another fork. Again, it would have tossed a coin. And again, with 50% probability from this point here, it can arrive at the cabin or be lost in the woods. So in the end, what we have is that as a sum of the total probabilities, there is still a 50% probability of getting lost and a 50% to arrive at the cabin. Okay. So can we take this classical example and just port it to our quantum mechanical experiment? So is it really true that here we will have 50-50% probability of arriving at the two detectors? Quantum mechanics is a bit different. So we saw that we can have this superposition state, alpha 0 plus beta 1. So in this case, the beam splitter, what it really does is to create one of these superpositions. I still want that the state after this beam splitter have 50-50% probability of being either down here or up here. So what I need is for my coefficient to be 1 over square root of 2, so that when squared, it will give 1 half or 50% probability. So what does this second beam splitter do on my state? So let's analyze it a bit more carefully. So if I start again coming in this direction, it's the same as the force beam splitter. I will have this 50% probability of going the two paths and the coefficient at 1 over square root of 2 in both cases. In the second case, if I'm arriving from the bottom here instead, the things are slightly different. I still want this 50-50% probability because this is the game of play, but what I can have is a minus sign here. This is an added phase, which is phases are very important in quantum mechanics. So this still gives me the same probability, but the state itself is a bit different. So when I add together all these possibilities that I have from coming on this side or coming from down here, what I obtain is that here I have 100% probability of getting my photon, this detector. Well, here I have 0% probability of getting my photon. So what does that mean? It means that in quantum mechanics, I can build an experiment, build a physical system, which in some sense, what it does is to make sure that my hacker always arrives safe at his cabin. Okay, so in this case, it's a photon, it's not a hacker, but I can always get the correct final goal. So this is the fourth ingredient, if you want, which is part of the quantum weirdness, this interference point that we get some destructive interference along one path and constructive interference along the other one so that I can get the correct answer. It is one of the ingredients of the power of quantum computer. So we need a second ingredient. So the second ingredient is given by, again, superposition, but we want to see how the superposition will build up. So we said that if I have one qubit, one of these quantum bits, I can have two possible states, and actually I can have both of them at the same time. So I need the two parameters, alpha and beta, in order to describe this state. So I need two classical bits in order to describe the same state. Now let's say that I have two qubits. In this case, I have four possible states. But I can also have them at all at the same time in a superposition like this. So we need four parameters, alpha, beta, gamma, and delta, in order to really describe the state. So what I need in terms of a classical computer, I will need four classical bits in order to really be able to describe this state. So you can imagine the pattern which emerges. If now I have three qubits, I will have eight states, eight parameters encoded in eight classical bits, and so on and so forth. So if I have 10, I already have 2 to the 10 classical bit, or 1 kilobit, if you want, in order to just describe this state. If I have 20, I have 1 megabit, 30, 1 gigabit, 40, 1 terabit. If I look at the table from the opposite side, what it tells me, if I want to have a 1 terabit of classical bits, I only need 40 qubits in order to represent the same type of information. So and this is sort of the hint to where the power of quantum computation comes from, because it's a very dense way of encoding information. But as we will see, we really need both of the two ingredients that I talked to you, so quantum superposition interference, in order to really make a quantum computer as powerful as they can be.